sure that they're not trying to go in her room and do anything to her.
Nyla Wingfield spoke with us only a moment before rushing back to the bedside of her 13-year-old daughter, Jahai, who came to Children's Hospital last Monday to have her tonsils removed. But there were complications. After surgery, she suffered a heart attack. Medical staff revived her, but doctors say she is brain dead.
Nobody called the doctor until it was too late. That's the problem. My daughter drowned on her own blood. And now I know it's Monday morning, it's business time. Now everybody's trying to cover it up. But you can't cover it up because God is going to help me find out the truth.
This family is demanding answers, claiming Children's Hospital is pressuring them to remove Jahai from life support.
And I'm still going to fight to keep her on, but they are just not compassionate. My daughter is a bed space. They need to get her out of there so they can move the next person's child in there and kill them too.
Nobody from the hospital would speak on camera today. Over the weekend, they said there are inherent risks with any surgery and unexpected tragedies can happen. In a written statement today, the chief of pediatrics says, "We are reviewing her case very closely. Our hearts go out to her family, and we want to support them during this extremely difficult time."
And I don't even have any tears no more because I'm all cried out. I'm angry.
Jahai's mom says her family continues to pray, hoping for a miracle. In Oakland, Cornell Bernard, ABC 7.
Man, most people have never even heard of this. It's called iatrogenic illness.
What? Say it again. Iatrogenic?
It's an illness caused by medical examination or treatment.
It's a hell of a middle school.
Actually, Ned's in high school now, Uncle Billy.
So you go in with one problem, you come out with another.
Yeah, that's if you come out.
Andrea.
What?
Yeah, I mean, it's the leading cause of death in the U.S.
What?
Wait a minute. Oh, no, it is. I swear. I mean, medical error. I mean, adverse drug reaction, right? Needless antibiotics, infection, unnecessary procedures.
What a cash cow for you.
You bet. In a 10-year period, right? 7.8 million iatrogenic deaths. I mean, that is more than all the casualties from all the wars fought in the history of the United States. It is true. It is true. The healthcare system is this nation's number one killer.
But the lawyers are making the real killing.
Yeah, you got that right. Here, here.
This place takes everything. Your dignity, your liver, your savings, your sense of humor, your name, your face.
You're in pain.
The shit you don't know. It's just the shit you don't want to look at. But it's all there, right there, floating, little turd of truth. Russia. Push him down. Face it.
I can't.
Don't question it. They'll call you a traitor, a lunatic, an unpatriotic ingrate.
What?
Your fear. My fear. That's what they depend on. You're a little white lamb. This is a fucking rendering plant. That's where it happens. Go over there and remember, if you think you can't help yourself, you're wrong.
An illegal kidney transplant ring has been uncovered, and it's sparking debate about medical ethics and organ transplant laws. Some poor Indians were allegedly forced onto this operating table at gunpoint, or were apparently tricked with promises of work, while others apparently willingly sold their kidney to make money. This man told the Associated Press a team of doctors offered him $2,500 for his kidney. And he says they warned him if he told authorities that they'd kill him. There have long been reports of the poor illegally selling kidneys, but a scam uncovered in this upscale New Delhi suburb is the most extensive to come to light. And it's the first with an element of so-called medical tourism. Authorities say a team of doctors sold up to 500 kidneys to clients who traveled to India from around the world over the past 9 years. The scam apparently involved dozens of medical professionals. The low cost of medical care in India has made it a popular destination for foreigners in need of everything from tummy tucks to heart surgery. But the sale of human organs is illegal in that country. Ed Donahue, The Associated Press.
This time I yield 2 minutes to a distinguished member of the Ways and Means Committee, the gentleman from Illinois, Mr. Roskam.
The gentleman from Illinois is recognized for 2 minutes.
I thank the gentleman for yielding, and thank you, Mr. Speaker. You know, Mr. Speaker, if you're at home and you were sort of flipping channels between the football games and C-SPAN and you flipped on and only heard the majority party, you'd think, wow, what a great plan. I mean, really, you'd think people are just going to fall all over themselves and all these adjectives and declarative statements, it just sounds wonderful. Until you look inside that bill and you find handcuffs. Now, I'm not talking about figurative handcuffs. I'm talking about criminal penalties. Criminal penalties that have been mentioned by the gentleman from Texas, criminal penalties that have been mentioned time and again on this floor. We've heard from the best and the brightest all afternoon, and not a one of them have answered why it is you have to criminalize people to coax them into a plan that's fabulous. It makes no sense. And this isn't my words. This is actually coming from the Joint Committee on Taxation, a letter that was written, ironically, with Chairman Charlie Rangel, as the chairman of that committee, released 48 hours ago, that says, in fact, if you don't comply with the individual mandate, what happens to you? You can be subject to 5 years in prison, and you can be subject to $250,000 in fines. And the other side, with all due respect, with all the adjectives and all the flourishing speech, have failed to answer that question. And I submit to you, if we listen today, if we listen to the remainder of this debate, they will be silent in terms of a good answer as to why it is you need to criminalize people to coax them into a plan. It's a failure. And we ought not stand for it. The small businesses, the entrepreneurs, and the self-employed that this would have an impact on, they say, look, you don't criminalize us. Give us relief. Let us purchase across state lines. Not in the Democrats' bill. Give us real tort reform, real liability reform. Not in the Democrats' bill in any substantive way. Let us purchase and work together to pool to lower costs down. The right to remain silent shouldn't be the word from the government. I yield back.
By now, that the healthcare industry spends more money than any other to buy politicians' votes in Washington. And you might already know that doctors rake in profits from prescribing pills so much that 70% of Americans are on at least one prescription drug. But you might not know this dirty little secret of the healthcare industry. Patients undergo surgery they don't need. Tens of thousands of times every year. A USA Today review of government records and medical databases found the practice of unnecessary surgeries is rampant in the US. In fact, they could account for 10 to 20% of all operations in some specialties. Patients often undergo pacemaker implants, knee replacements, hysterectomies, gallbladder removals, and other procedures when they have no medical reason to do so on a frequent basis. One study from 2011 looked into more than 100,000 cardioverter defibrillator procedures and found that 22.5% of them had no justification whatsoever. Another study found that 17% of a particular spinal procedure were completely unwarranted. About 10% of all spinal fusions paid for by Medicare in 2011 were not necessary. And 12% of all angioplasty procedures did not need to happen. So why does this happen, you ask? The report points to three categories for the unnecessary surgeries: the incompetent, the indifferent, and the immoral. Many doctors are just not well-trained or competent, even though we treat them like gods oftentimes. Then there are some that are more businessmen than medical professionals, who look at cases that could go either way and say, well, I have enough to justify the surgery, so I'm going to do it. And then there are the flat-out crooks, who are just blatantly in it for the money. And there is a ton of it to be made in the healthcare industry these days. Surgeons bill Medicare, Medicaid, and insurance companies huge amounts of dollars for these surgeries that don't need to happen. The total amount that these shysters take of our American tax and insurance dollars is enormous and criminal. But when you live in a country with a crooked, for-profit healthcare system whose mantra is greed is good, can you blame them? With the money-centric state of our country today, unnecessary surgeries for profit is kind of just what the doctor ordered.
It's corruption. I met a guy who's paid $2,000 as a recruiter, paying folks $200 to come in and have an unnecessary surgery.
Yeah, I saw this. I saw this online.
What is it with you and surgery?
The surgery clinics bill the insurance companies $10,000-$20,000 to cut on immigrants. Cubans, Guatemalans, Mexicans, Vietnamese.
What, a cosmetic surgery?
Unnecessary nose jobs, endoscopic bullshit, circumcisions.
But for $200?
Colonoscopies. Get this, sympathectomies. You know what that is?
Oh, yeah, sympathectomies. That's a cure for bleeding heart liberals. Look it up.
A thoracoscopic sympathectomy. They go in right here, make a small incision, put in an endoscope, collapse a lung, and snip a nerve somewhere near your spine. It's a cure
for sweaty palms.
Oh. George?
I want to leave this place. I want to leave this place right fucking now!
Lynn Spaulding had been in hospital for just 2 days. She was being treated for an infection, but in just a few minutes, between nurse visits, she vanished from her room. The hospital was searched, and police opened a missing persons investigation. Friends tried to find her. A Facebook page was launched to try and track her down. They even searched the neighborhood. But then, 17 days after she disappeared, her body was found in an outside fire exit stairwell on the hospital's fourth floor. It was rarely used and supposed to be locked and alarmed.
And at this time, we don't know what happened. We are here to provide patient care and security to 100,000 patients and their families each year. Nothing like this has ever happened before. There is no precedent for this.
Lynn Spaulding had reported being disorientated by the medication she was taking, but was thought to be in good condition. It's not known how she died.
I understand there have been some problems with your care here at Mount Aberdeen.
Oh, that's a good start.
That your experience has been less than positive.
Who are you again?
I'm chief counsel for Mount Aberdeen.
Oh, you're a lawyer.
I am also a physician.
Oh, you're a physician. You're double billed. That's great. That must work out well for you. That's a fancy suit. It's a crackerjack of a suit. I bet you make a bundle, and I bet you can tell me what they've been putting in this fucking IV here.
Vancomycin and Maxiprime every 6 hours. Morphine, hydrocodone.
Morphine.
For the pain.
What pain?
Let's review.
Let's.
Our records indicate that on the 23rd, you were admitted for routine colonoscopy.
That's right. That's right. The day after my birthday.
Indeed. Unfortunately, a patient by the name of Jorge Grieves was to receive a thoracoscopic sympathectomy on the same floor.
Go figure.
A mistake was made.
I guess a mistake was fucking made. I guess a mistake was made. How'd it go?
How did what go, Mr. Greaves?
The colonoscopy. I got the sympathectomy. I assume that Mr. Grieves got the colonoscopy.
Yes, actually.
I wasn't fucking talking to you. How'd it go?
Mr. Grieves' procedure was complicated by the fact that he...
The fact that he wasn't clean, he wasn't prepared, he was still full of shit, wasn't he?
The FBI says it also stumbled upon a Brooklyn man who was offering to broker the sale of human kidneys. They say for $160,000, he would find donors in Israel who needed the money and then fool U.S. hospitals that the donor and recipient were related. They say he'd been doing this for more than 10 years.
And prosecutors say rabbis at synagogues in New Jersey and New York helped the informant launder over $3 million by sending it to contacts in Israel who returned cash.
The FBI says some New Jersey officials appeared suspicious of the informant, but never wary enough to pass up the cash. Pete Williams, NBC News at the Justice Department.
Welcome to the Outback Steakhouse.
It's the second time Jacqueline Johnson cried next to her son Kendrick's grave. The first time he was being lowered into the ground. This time he's being pulled out of it.
Did you ever expect you'd have to exhume his body?
No, I didn't expect to have to bury his body.
In June, Kendrick's body was sent to Florida. The Johnsons hired Dr. Bill Anderson to conduct an independent second autopsy. In that autopsy, Anderson told the Johnsons he'd found evidence that Kendrick died as the result of a blow to the neck and not accidental asphyxia after slipping into a rolled gym mat at school, as investigators in Georgia had said. But what Dr. Anderson did not find shocked them.
When we got the body for the second autopsy, that organs, the heart, lungs, liver, etc., were not with the body.
The brain?
The brain, they were all absent.
Every organ from the top of Kendrick's head to his pelvis gone, and his family had no idea.
We have been let down again, and when we buried Kendrick, we thought we was burying Kendrick, not half of Kendrick.
I'm not sure at this point who did not return the organs to the body, but I know when we got the body, the organs were not there.
So, CNN contacted the two entities that had custody of Kendrick's body and access to his organs, the Georgia Bureau of Investigation, which conducted the first autopsy in January, and Harrington Funeral Home, which the Johnsons chose to embalm and prepare Kendrick's body for burial days later. A spokeswoman for the state tells CNN after its autopsy, the organs were placed in Johnson's body, the body was closed, then the body was released to the funeral home. State investigators say it's their normal practice, but what happened after his body arrived at the funeral home was anything but normal.
What was in the place of the organs?
Newspaper.
Newspaper.
Dr. Anderson showed me the pictures of Kendrick's body he'd taken during the second autopsy.
It's a Black Friday ad, JCPenney ad.
Yes.
Stuffing that newspaper in like he was a garbage can inside his body. It's unbelievable.
I'd imagine that that's a different kind of pain.
Yep.
Why do you think that there would be newspaper stuffed in your child?
I never heard of that before. Never.
Neither had the founder of a national embalming academy contacted by CNN, who said it's not consistent with the standards of care in the industry. Nor had the president of the National Association of Medical Examiners, who told CNN he's never heard of this practice.
Why would the funeral home discard his organs and stuff them with newspaper?
The question is, why did he tell us?
So what exactly did the Harrington Funeral Home do with Kendrick's organs? And why was he stuffed with old newspaper? We went to their office to find out, but their response to us? No comment. However, in a letter to the Johnson's attorney, Harrington Funeral Home owner Antonio Harrington denies he received Kendrick's organs. He writes in part, his internal organs were destroyed through natural process and henceforth were discarded before the body was sent back to Valdosta. It's another disappointing answer for parents determined to know what happened to their son before and now after his death. And they admit they're struggling.
Unbearable, just about. Only thing that wakes you up in the morning is just to keep pushing.
A mob in Madagascar has burned two Europeans to death amid claims they were involved in organ trafficking for witchcraft. An angry crowd hunted down and killed the Frenchman and Franco-Italian. A third man from Madagascar was also lynched after rumours spread among the crowd that the trio were involved in the disappearance of a child and the removal of his organs. The body of an 8-year-old boy was apparently found without genitals and without a tongue. The unrest arrest in Nosy Be, one of the Indian Ocean Islands' leading tourism hubs, prompted safety warnings by French and Italian authorities to their citizens.